Welcome, I'm Bob Lund.
And I'm Chris Rivard with Fastenal Engineering. Boy, have we got a good one for you today.
What are we gonna do, Chris? I see this little gizmo here and I don't know what it is. Well, I guess I do, but you tell us.
We're talking about the relationship between torque and tension. And this device here is called a Skidmore Wilhelm machine. And really what that is, it's a load cell. So that's gonna help us understand the tension aspect. And when we use it in conjunction with something like a torque wrench, we can start to understand that relationship between torque and tension.
So tightening seems like it should be easy. As long as you've got that righty-tighty, lefty-loosey thing figured out, most customers assume that they're doing a good enough job. And there's levels of good enough, I guess. If you assume that I've been doing this for 20 years, I think I know when tight is tight, or as we call it,
the calibrated elbow.
We also have the calibrated ear method for people that want to use an impact wrench and go by how many ugga-luggas they've tightened to. But realistically, torque is a much better way to get a more accurate level of tightness. And what we're really trying to do when we're tightening is put a certain amount of force on whatever it is you're clamping together. We know that the outside forces, if you, for example, are driving a bobcat and you're lifting something up with a front-end loader and you've got X amount of pounds in it, you can calculate back to the joints how much load will be seen, you know, on a bolted joint. We want to make sure we've got more force pushing together than all the forces that are trying to pull things apart.
Absolutely. And that force, or F, is incorporated in our torque formula.
Let's go there.
It's a relatively simple formula. T equals K times D times F. F being that force. K being a cousin of the coefficient of friction. We call it the K factor or nut factor. And we're going to dive into that a little bit here today. And D is simply just the diameter, nominal diameter of your fastener.
And on the force side of things, we're not here to get too deep into the woods, but essentially with bolts, we want them to be springs in our mind, and they stretch as you tighten them to a certain point. They'll break at what we call the tensile load. A little bit below that is a yield point, which is really where they permanently stretch and don't come back. The slinky is no longer looking like a slinky.
And we want to stay away from that.
We do. And the proof load is really the kind of top end of the usable range of that bolt. We start with that proof load and go to 75% of that as kind of our target. Why do we need to start even lower than proof?
Well, the real world is unpredictable. Our tools are, they're not perfect. There's gonna be some inaccuracies in there. And so all of this, that 75% of proof, is really trying to give us a little bit of safety factor to ensure that we're not gonna yield that bolt.
And that's really part of what we're gonna demo today, the inaccuracies involved in tightening, even when you have a torque wrench in your hand. So let's go ahead and introduce the Skidmore here by showing I've got a brand new, out of the package, grade 5, clear zinc plated bolt, a hardened washer, and a grade 5 nut.
So rather than us doing the math, we can just use our handy torque slider. So we slide it over to our 3A16. We know we're using a grade 5 fastener. We can see we're trying to develop roughly 5,000 pounds of clamping force. And in a dry scenario, we haven't added any sort of lubricant here, we're looking for about 31 foot-pounds of torque.
I am setting my torque wrench to zero, and I'm gonna tighten up to go to 5,000 pounds and see where we end up with for torque. So there we're at about 5,000 pounds, and oh my, 48 foot-pounds of torque.
Well, that's not 31.
I guess that 31 wasn't very accurate. Maybe if I do it a second time, we'll get better results. The torque wrench is re-zeroed out. The load cell is back to zero. And I'm gonna tighten up to about the 5,000 pound area again. This time we're about 55 foot-pounds. So I was hoping we'd come back down into the right neighborhood, but we actually went up even further. Maybe one more try. I also saw something a little bit odd, that right as I was getting up to about my 5,000 pound load level, the needle didn't move quite like it used to.
So as that needle starts to stop its movement.
We're there.
You continue to turn.
I just broke it. And that took 58 foot-pounds of torque, and we didn't even get to our 5,000-pound clamp load. Was there something wrong with a bolt?
I don't know. We should probably try another.
All right. I'm going to continue and break that all the way out.
Well, this time, for this demonstration, I'm going to simulate more like what an assembler would be doing, because I'll have my torque wrench and I've got my directive to follow a torque chart, and that's going to be telling us to use that 31 foot-pounds. So let's just go by standard guidance. And so there we are.
Let me see.
We're at 31 foot-pounds.
Well, we're supposed to be tightening to 5,000 pounds worth of clamp force, but we only got to
3,000.
3,000. So if I'm doing the calculations based on an outside load and I'm worried about it overcoming the amount of force I have clamping things together, we could be in trouble.
Yeah, and based on what we learned about your first install with torque requiring more and more torque to get to that 5,000 pounds, if we were to simulate just a reuse here, so we back everything off, zero our torque wrench back out, and yet we go back to our 31 foot-pounds. Let's see, we are seeing a correlation there. We're under 3,000 pounds of clamping force at our 31 foot-pounds.
You did stop at 31 again. Huh. I'd like to see you do one more. Like this, back up to 31.
Back up to 31, okay. Zero everything out.
Well, you're doing all the work. I stole your Doritos.
We're back to our 31 foot-pounds. And we're still in that same ballpark. We're under 3,000 pounds. Something's odd here.
So I did this two or three times. Let me finish your Dorito, sorry. And I was way higher on the torque that it took. You stopped at 31 and are way low on the load.
Yep.
Let's have you do this one more time, since I'm hungry. And we'll let you do what I did and stop at 5,000 pounds worth of clamping force and see what numbers you get.
Okay. We are at about 26 foot-pounds.
Wait a minute, that's about half of where we were before. Try it again. At least we've been consistent that we've gone up on the torque that it took every time. So I'm guessing this should be 35 or something.
27, maybe 28.
So it's staying right in that same
vicinity.
All right.
So what do we think is going on here, Bob? We did jump to about 30 here this time.
So when we do these type of trainings for our customers, I let this play out a little bit more, and I walk around and ask if anyone has an idea of what might have happened. And nobody knows, so I ask if anyone would like a hint. And I sit there rudely eating in front of them. And as it turns out, we're trying to get the point across that something as simple as having a chip during a break, or frozen pizza, or leftover pizza from last night, or any type of a greasy, oily food.
Accidental lubrication.
Is an accidental lubrication. Putting hand lotion on your hands. What person that turns a wrench for a living doesn't have a little bit of oil or grease on their fingers? So anything like that can dramatically change the lubricity of the bolt and thus change the torque that we need to get there. So the goal is, and as you notice, I just took one chip and rubbed my fingers on the threads just a tiny little bit. If we were to do this again and I had a few more chips and was able to rub it on the threads a little bit more, we'd probably be down in the 22, 23 foot-pound level just because of the grease from the chips.
So we achieved consistency with lubrication. We also did see our first dry installations really weren't that accurate. They didn't correlate well with stated torque charts anyhow. And you're saying it's easy to accidentally lubricate anyway.
So I think we should unravel a little bit of that. Why did it go up every time when we were using dry? And why was it so far away to begin with? We should probably at least talk about that.
Well, with every installation, you're flattening those surfaces out, creating more surface contact between the nut and bolt threads. When you have more surface contact, it requires, you're increasing the friction between these two surfaces. So the resulting action is it requires more torque to get these to move.
So you're saying the threads aren't glass smooth, and underneath the head or the nut, whatever you're tightening, isn't glass smooth. So you got high spots and low spots. And as you're putting that 5,000 pounds worth of force on, there's a coefficient of squish kind of thing that's happening, where you're taking those high spots and low spots and flattening them out. Now you get more surface to surface contact, and you need more torque to overcome that. Okay. That makes sense.
But a good lubricant can counteract all of that.
So do we need to supply Doritos with all of our bolts? Or I guess people can get a spray can of a lubricant, or drops of a lubricant, or...
Certainly, but those can be messy.
Pasting, absolutely. We actually, one of the reasons why we see such a high load, required torque load required to begin with, lately, the last half a dozen years, has been the onset of sealers and top coats that are helping with corrosion resistance. But unless a customer specifically says in their standard, hey, I want to dial in a slipperiness, a coefficient of friction, it can be a stickier or a slipperier sealer or a top coat, and it throws the torques way out the window.
So unless you're specifying, you don't really know what you're gonna get.
Exactly. So what we've done, and you've got a bag here of our F&L 240 sealer, and those parts take our standard off-the-shelf indoor plating from about a 24-hour salt spray test to 240 hours. And with that L, this is the lubricated version, we should see that integrated lubricant make us much more consistent on the torque value. So on our torque sliders for this size of bolt, it says that if we're really slippery, like our EcoGuard coating, we're gonna need to be at about 20 foot-pounds of torque, and something like a machine oil should take us to about 23 foot-pounds of torque in order to get tight.
And here we are at 17 foot-pounds.
Oh, so really, really slippery.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah, so that L in the 240L is our integrated lubricant. It's a PTFE-based lubricant that we put in there that's going to counteract most of those outside accidental lubrication types of scenarios. What we'd hope to see here is some pretty good consistency. And we're probably about 16 foot-pounds.
Okay, so right in that same vicinity. And we can do this 6, 8, 10 times, and you'll probably have basically the same torque to clamp load relationship.
Or maybe right around 18.
Okay. So I guess the goal here was to help people understand that torque alone, while it's much better than the alternatives of relatively impacts, cheap. And it's relatively cheap, you still have to understand the lubrication of it and use a lubricated torque value because you're going to get only truly good results when you do that. You can use all kinds of different lubricants. Just use a lubricant. By the way, you care for a lubricant?
Sure. Thanks, Bob.
Okay. How can people get more information on this?
Well, if you found this interesting and maybe want to explore a little deeper, reach out to us at engineer@fastenal.com.
Thank you.
Thanks.